Church family. If you have your Bibles with you today, turn with me to the book of Luke. We're going to be in Luke chapter 19. Luke chapter 19. As you turn there, one of my heroes of the faith would have to be Billy Graham. Until his death in 2018, Billy Graham was still preaching the gospel message of Jesus Christ. And one of the things I love about Billy Graham is no matter what the conversation, he would always find a way to bring Jesus into the conversation. I mean, in the instance, in 1996, Billy Graham and his wife Ruth were awarded the Congressional Gold Medal for their service to America. After the presentation, Dr. Graham was interviewed by Diane Sawyer. And at the interview, he said, "Ruth and I are humbled by this award. But the only recognition I'm looking forward to is when I stand before the Lord Jesus Christ. My greatest reward will be to hear him say, 'Well done, good and faithful servant.'" Now, you've probably heard that phrase before. It comes from the passage we're going to look at today in Luke 19 and a parable that Jesus told. Now, the interesting thing about this parable is it's not just a parable. It's actually a fictional story, but it's based on actual historical events. But before we read it, let's catch up to where we are with Jesus on the road to the cross. As we follow Jesus on the road to the cross these last few weeks, we saw Jesus visit Jericho. And there he encountered a blind man named Bartimaeus. And then he encountered a tax collector whose name was Zacchaeus. And now Jesus is continuing on toward Jerusalem. And to kind of give you an idea, Jericho is 1,300 feet below sea level. It's the lowest city in the world. Jerusalem is 2,500 feet above sea level. So that 20-mile trip, it's uphill. But I want you to know, for Jesus, it was uphill for more than just a geographical reason. Jesus knew he was going to the cross. He knew that he'd be tortured. He knew that he'd be arrested. He knew that he'd be crucified. But he's on his way on the road to Jerusalem. Well, let's pick up today's story in Luke chapter 19, starting at verse 11. So Luke 19, 11, here's what it says. "And as they heard these things, he added and spoke a parable, because he was nigh to Jerusalem, and because they thought that the kingdom of God should appear immediately. And he said, therefore, a certain nobleman went into a far country to receive for himself a kingdom and to return. And he called his 10 servants and delivered them 10 pounds and said to them, 'Occupy till I come.' But his citizens hated him and sent a message after him saying, 'We will not have this man to reign over us.' And it came to pass that when he was returned, having received the kingdom, then he commanded these servants to be called unto him, to whom he had given the money, that he might know how much every man had gained by trading. Then came the first, saying, 'Lord, thy pound has gained 10 pounds. And he said unto them, Well, thou good servant, because thou hast been faithful in very little, thou have authority over 10 cities. And the second came, saying, 'Lord, thy pound has gained 5 pounds. And he said, likewise to him, Be thou over 5 cities. And another came, saying, 'Lord, behold, here is that pound which I have kept laid up in a napkin. For I feared thee, because thou art an austere man. Thou takest up what thou layest not down, and reapest thou what thou didst not sow. And he said unto him, Out of thine own mouth will I judge thee, thou wicked servant. Thou knowest that I was an austere man, taking up that I laid not down, and reaping that I did not sow. Wherefore then gavest not thou my money into the bank, that at my coming I might have required my own with usury? And he said to them that stood by, Take from him the pound, and give it to him that has 10 pounds. And they said unto him, Lord, he only has 10 pounds. For I say unto you, that unto every one which hath shall be given, and from him that hath not, even that he has shall be taken away from him. But those mine enemies, which would not that I should reign over them, bring hither and slay them before me." Now, Jesus is nearing Jerusalem, and the people thought that the kingdom of God was going to appear at once. They just knew Jesus was the Messiah, and they believed that he was going to go to Jerusalem and there immediately set up his kingdom. And it was this time that Jesus told this parable. And he said, there was a man of noble birth, and he went to a distant country to have himself appointed as king and then return. And he called his servants in, he called 10 servants, and he gave each one of them a mina. Now, a mina was worth about 3 months' wages. And he told them, "Put this money to work until I come back. Put this to work until I come back." But his subjects hated him. And they sent a delegation after him to tell him, "We don't want this man to be our king." But he was made to be king anyway. And when he returned, he sent for his servants that he'd given the money to. And he had each one of them report. And the first one came and he said, "Sir, your mina has earned 10 more." And he said, well done, my good servant. And he said, "You've been trustworthy in a very small matter. I'll give you charge over 10 cities. The second one come, and kind of the same, "Sir, your mina has earned 5 more." And he says, "I put you in charge of 5 cities." But the last servant came, and he said, "Sir, here's your mina. I kept it laid up in a napkin because I was afraid of you. I knew you were a hard man, and I knew you take what you didn't from what you didn't sow, and you reap what you didn't sow." And he said, "So I just kept your mina." And the master said, "You said I'm a hard man. I'm going to judge you by your own words, you wicked servant. You knew. You just thought that I was a hard man, taking what I didn't put into and reaping what I didn't sow." He said, "So I'm going to take your mina, and I'm going to give it to this guy who gained 10. You didn't even take it and put it on deposit so that at least I could have interest from it. You did nothing." And the folks said, "Well, sir, he already has 10. Why are you giving it to him?" And then we find a truth that we need to listen to today. He said, "I'll tell you, everyone who has more will be given more. But those who have nothing, even what he has, will be taken away." And he said, "Those enemies of mine who followed me because they didn't want me to be king, bring them here. I want to see them executed right here in front of me." You know, now as we look at this parable that Jesus told, this parable's kind of like an onion. There are so many layers to this parable. So I want us to unpeel 3 layers of this parable. And the first thing I want us to look at is I want us to look at the historical meaning. As we look at a parable, let's look this morning at the historical meaning of the parable. I told you that this is a fictional story that Jesus told, but it's based on actual events. In 4 BC, Archelaus, who was the son of Herod the Great, traveled to Rome to try to be crowned ruler of all Judea. He went with that purpose. Now, he was the son of Herod the Great, and we all know Herod the Great wasn't so great. The only thing he was great at was building, and because he was a great builder, he named himself, he actually gave himself that title, Herod the Great. But Herod's the guy that we find in Scripture. You remember when Jesus was born? And the wise men came, and they first came to Jerusalem, and they said, "Where is he, the born king of the Jews?" And they went before Herod, and Herod says, "I don't know, but I'll find out." And Herod told them, you go find him, worship him, and then come back and tell me so I can go worship him as well. Well, we know Herod didn't want to worship Jesus. He was very mean and he was very jealous. And basically what he wanted to do, he wanted to kill Jesus. He wanted to eliminate the competition. Well, when he found out the wise men didn't come back, he ordered that every baby boy 2 years old and under be killed. So Herod wasn't really Herod the Great. Herod was the great murderer. And Archelaus was his son, and Archelaus now wanted to be king. So he goes to Rome to try to get the blessing so that he can be crowned king of all Judea. But when Herod died, Herod the Great died, there was a mix-up in his will. And part of the mix-up was he'd written six different wills. And that mix-up was one where nobody really knew who he intended to follow him as leader, who he intended to follow him on the throne. So Archelaus wanted to be king. Also, his son Antipas wanted to be king. And both of them were trying to claim the throne. So just like in the parable, Archelaus goes to Rome to try to get the blessing so that he could be crowned or confirmed as ruler. Well, that didn't quite work out for him because he goes there and Caesar Augustus says, you know, here's what I'll do. I'm not going to make you ruler over all of it. I'm actually going to help send you and so that you're going to be ruler over part of it. But you see, nobody liked Archelaus. He was just as mean and vicious as his father. So the Jews sent an official delegation to Rome following Archelaus of 50 men or 50 leading Jews to try to convince them, don't make him king. Well, Archelaus bribed supporters so that it looked like he had a bunch of supporters, and he goes before Caesar. But Caesar didn't crown Archelaus. What he did was he made him ruler over Judah. He made his brother, Antipas, he gave him Galilee. And the area east of Jordan, he gave to Herod's other living son, Philip. So he basically divided Herod the Great's kingdom three ways and gave them all part of that leadership. Well, Archelaus was now mad. You know, here are these folks who had opposed him, and now he didn't get to be king over everything. So when he come back, he actually had over 1,000 Jews put to death right in front of him because they had opposed him and were against him. Now, Archelaus is only mentioned one time in Scripture that I can find. And you remember when Herod was going to kill the baby boys and Mary and Joseph fled to Egypt? As they fled to Egypt, they stayed there for a time and they're coming back. And Matthew chapter 2 verse 22 says that when they heard that Archelaus was ruler over Judea, that they passed that area and went to Galilee to live. It's the only time Archelaus is mentioned. But Jesus is using that historical story as the backdrop for the parable that he's telling here today. Now, as we look at the parable, I want us to unpeel another layer of it. I want us to now to look not only to the historical meaning, I want us to look at the spiritual meaning. Jesus used this story. What they knew it could have been a true story because it so mirrored what they knew. But he used it to teach them some spiritual things. This morning, I want us to look at three spiritual things that he looks here. And the first is, just like in the story, the real story, Jesus is going to return as king. Just like he told in this parable, Jesus will return as king. And we know that to be a fact. Verse 11 tells us that many of the Jews thought the kingdom was going to happen right then. There were many folks who they believed Jesus was the Messiah. But they thought that Jesus was going to go, and he was going to be, as soon as he got to Jerusalem, he was going to set up a kingdom that would be greater than any other kingdom that Israel had ever seen. That's what they were expecting. But Jesus tells them this parable to confirm the fact that he had to leave, and then he would return and be king. Now, if you think about it, the first time Jesus came, gentle Jesus, meek and mild, lowly in the stable, a child. But when he comes back as king, our scripture tells us he will come as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He will come as that righteous ruler. So when we look at it, we see Jesus is going to return, just like the parable. Jesus will return as king. But there's a second spiritual meaning I want you to see here, and that's just like in the parable, Jesus has given gifts to his servants. In the parable, the prospective king gave each called 10 servants and gave them each a mina. And as we look at it, he told them, he says, I want you to do business until I come back. Take this mina and do business until I return. Now, I want to stop here for a moment because I don't want you to get this parable confused with the story that we find in Matthew chapter 25. Because there's a lot of similar aspects there, but it's two different stories, and it's two different meanings from those stories. In Matthew chapter 25, the master gave to one servant 5 talents. He gave to one servant 2 talents, and to another he gave 1 talent. And each one of them was to take and use the different talents he gave in different ways for whatever. In this parable, Jesus gives all the servants, he gives all 10 of them, the exact same amount. He's teaching an entirely different lesson here, and it's two different stories. So don't get the two confused. But looking at that, in this parable, he gives each one of them 1 mina. Now, I told you earlier, a mina is equal to about 3 months' salary for the working person. So to kind of give you an idea what it would be like for them, I want you to take your salary for a month, times it by 3, and what you're going to figure out is this is not a small amount. You know, even if we're a low-paid person, this is still not a small amount. It's something worthwhile. It wasn't just a little bit of pocket change that the servant gives. It's here, you know, this will hold you over till I get back. He was actually giving them a gracious amount to use. And as he did, he tells them, I'm going to go away. I want you to do business until I come back. And Jesus does the same thing. Jesus went to heaven. Our Bible tells us he ascended to the Father, but what did he tell us? You know, I'm going to prepare a place for you, and I will come again. Jesus, just like this story, he's coming back. And in the meantime, he's given gifts to his servants. He's told his servants, use these gifts and do business until I come back. Now we know as Christians, we're each given different spiritual gifts. We're given different talents. We're given different abilities. But in this story, Jesus gave them all the exact same. And as we think about it, there are some things that Jesus has given to each of us that are the exact same as it is that everybody else has. Let's look at 3 of them real quick. The first one is we all have the same amount of time. There's only 24 hours in a day. Nobody has more. Nobody has less. We are all given the exact same amount of time. So the question is, what are we doing with our mina? What are we doing with the time that Jesus has given us? Another thing that we have the same is Jesus has given us all the same truth. Every one of us has a Bible. That's the amount of truth that God has given us. We have no more. We have no less. So we have to look at it and we ask, you know, what are we doing with our mina? What are we doing with the truth that God has given us? The third thing that I find that we have is we all have the same opportunities to serve. Now, they may come looking differently, but every one of us as followers of Christ are giving opportunities to serve. So we have to ask, what are we doing with those opportunities to serve? Let's put that into perspective. I mean, let's face it. Right now, our nation's a mess. And there's really no other way to describe it. Our nation is a mess. We have folks who are hurting. We have folks who are afraid. Well, we have folks who are totally in a panic because of what's happening right now. You know, but as we look at this mess, we have to ask, what are we going to do with our opportunities to serve? So let's say here in West Virginia, we're what? A week and a half, 2 weeks into this thing? You know, so as we look, we're about that far in. In the last week and a half to 2 weeks, what have we used this as? This pandemic, they call it. What are we using this pandemic as in opportunities to serve? Because you see, we're doing one of two things. We're either taking this pandemic and looking at ourselves only. Oh yeah, we look at our families and our friends, but we're focusing on self. Or we're using it as opportunities to serve. You know, so where's our focus been during this time? So when we look at it, we have to ask, what are we doing with the gifts God has given us? During this pandemic, what are we doing with our time? What are we doing with the truth of God's word? What are we doing with opportunities that God has given us to serve? Folks, I can tell you, I've had more opportunities in the last 2 weeks to tell people about Jesus than I have found in maybe sometimes in a month or two together. Folks are hungry. What are we doing for opportunities to serve? And with that in mind, that God has given each gift to his servants, we need to look at the third spiritual meaning. The third spiritual meaning is we will be judged by how we manage his gifts. In the parable, the king returned and it required a personal accounting from each of his servants. Each one came before him to give an account to what they did with their mina. You remember the first one comes and said, I made you 10 more. Next one comes, I made you 5 more. Each one was to give an account. In the same way, every one of us is going to be judged by Jesus Christ. Every born-again believer is going to stand before him at the judgment seat of Christ and give an account for what we've done with our mina. Jesus said, here, I give you these gifts. Do business until I return. What have we been done? Because he will judge us. He will judge on how we have managed our time. He will judge us on how we have handled God's truth. He will judge us on the opportunities that he's given us to serve him. Christ has given every believer gifts, and he told them, take care of business until I return. And when he returns, what will he find in you? Let's say, what if Jesus returns today? What will he find in you? So as we look at the Spirit, as we look at this parable, we see there's a historical meaning. We see there's a spiritual meaning. But I want us to look at, I want us to unpeel one last thing. I want us to see there's a personal meaning. And as we look at the personal meaning, we're going to look at three things here. The first is, those who reject the king's authority will be rejected. Think about the story. Remember that crowd? Remember those who followed the nobleman to the other place where he was going to be appointed king because they didn't like him? They despised him, it said. And they went along and they come back. They're trying to convince him, we don't want him to be our king. I want you to look at verse 27. I want you to see what happened to them. Verse 27 says, but these my enemies, have them brought to me and have them slain before me. Those who reject the king's authority will be rejected. You know, there's a whole lot of folks today who reject Jesus. Now, it is obvious when we look at those radical, outspoken folks who make a lot of noise against Christ. It's easy to look at them, but you know what? Those who are rejecting Jesus would be anyone who doesn't have a personal relationship with Jesus. Anyone who has not accepted Christ as their Savior and made him their Lord are rejecting Jesus. Because if you think about it, if I'm not trusting Jesus for my salvation, who am I trusting? I'm trusting myself. I've made myself God. I choose to save me. I choose to save me through my works, through my good deeds. I choose to save me by going to church. I choose to save me by reading my Bible. I made me God. And if I'm trying to save myself, I'm not trusting Jesus. Just like in the parable, if we don't have a personal relationship with Jesus, we're rejecting him. And what does he say? Those who reject me, I will reject before the Father. On that day of judgment, if I've rejected Christ, he's going to reject me. So as we look at that personal meaning from the story, those who reject the king's authority are going to be rejected. But I want you to see something else. That if you fearfully hide God's resources, you risk losing them. So our second thought is, if we're going to hide what God's given, the gifts God's given to us, we risk losing those. In verse 21, the unfaithful servant reported, I was afraid of you. And here's his opinion of the master. And I say his opinion because none of the other servants had this opinion. He gave them all one mina. One of them goes out and makes 10 minas with it. Another one goes out and makes 5. Never did they say, oh, you're a hard man, hard to get along with. You reap what you don't sow and you take from what you didn't plant. Only this guy says, here's my thought, my opinion of you. I'm scared to death of you. I'm afraid of what you would do. And remember what the master did? He says, okay, I'll judge you by your own words. You think that I'm a hard man? Then I'm going to be a hard man. You think that I can't get along with anybody? Then I can't get along with you. And he takes his own thoughts and rejects him there. You know, I believe that today there's a lot of Christians who are just like that man. I believe today there's a lot of folks who God has given them gifts and they're not using them. I believe today there's a lot of folks that God has given them 24 hours in a day and they do little to nothing to glorify God with it. I believe that God has given them truth and they don't do anything with that truth. I believe God has given them opportunities to serve. But just like this man, they stay hid and won't use those opportunities. If that's the case, God has given them great gifts and they refuse to use them, but there's coming a judgment day. And on that judgment day, God will look at them and say, depart from me. Now here's what I think we think. I think we've gotten this idea that because God is such a loving God, that he's going to look at us when we haven't used our gifts, when we've taken them and just stuck them on a shelf, oh, I'm saved and that's all I need. Like the old song, I'll just take a little cabin in the corner of Glory Land. That's not what Jesus taught in the parable. Jesus says, take those gifts and do business till I come. But we've got this idea that God's going to look at us because he loves us so much. And he's going to look at us and go, oh, that's okay. I know you're shy. So it's okay you didn't tell anybody about my son. Or maybe God's going to look at us and go, you were afraid during that time. I understand. If I was in your shoes, I'd probably be afraid too. We've got this idea that that's what God's going to do to us. But we think God's going to look at us and go, oh, you had so much going on in your life. It's okay that you didn't do anything with your mina. You were so busy with other stuff. I totally understand. Or maybe we got this idea that God's going to go, oh, honey, you've been through so much. I think we'll just waive the fact that you did nothing with your mina. We've got this idea, but you know what we find here? When that man came before the master, he had to give an account. And he said, I didn't do anything with my mina. I didn't do anything with the gift you gave me. And you know what Christ is going to say to us? On that day that we stand before him and we've not done anything with our mina, we've not done anything with the gracious gifts that he's given to us, he's going to say, look at all the time I gave you and you did nothing. Look at the truth I gave you and you didn't follow it. Look at the opportunities I gave you to serve and you wasted every one of us. Just like that unfaithful servant, he wasn't rewarded. Neither will we be. Instead, the master took his mina and gave it to somebody who was going to do something with it. And the witnesses cried out, that's not fair. Jesus stated a principle in verse 26 that we need to look at again. He said, everyone who has, more will be given. But as for the one who has not, as for the one who has nothing, even what he has will be taken away. Folks, I want you to know something. Jesus has given you a great gift. What are you doing with it? He's given you the gift of time. What are you doing with it? He's given you the gift of truth. What are you doing with it? He's given you opportunities to serve. What are you doing with those opportunities? Because you know what Jesus is telling us? Jesus is telling us that either you use it or you lose it. What are you doing with that gift? You know, if we faithfully invest God's resources, what does he tell us? He'll give us much more. The one who took that mina, took the gift God gave and used it and gained 10 times more, Jesus said, or the master said, I give you 10 cities. And the one who took that mina and got 5 times more, he says, I give you 5 cities. But that one who did nothing got no blessing from the master. And you say, well, how's God going to bless us? How will God bless our time? God's not going to give you more hours in the day because you've served him. Or what if I'm faithful to the truth? God's not going to reveal to you something from Scripture that nobody else has ever found. He's revealed to us all that we need here. No new revelation is going to be given until we get to glory. But you know what he'll do? He will bless us because we've used that mina. On the road to the cross, Jesus told a story. And it's a parable that today we look at our lives. Oh, we look at the historical meaning. And we look at the spiritual meaning. And we look at the personal meaning. And we ask ourselves, what am I doing with the gifts that God has given me? I want to ask you this morning, what are you doing with your mina? Maybe this morning you find there's things that need to change. Maybe right now the Holy Spirit of God is speaking to you, your innermost thoughts, to say, you need to change some things now. Then I want to challenge you, right where you're at, go to God for forgiveness. Seek that forgiveness. The Scripture tells us if we seek his forgiveness, he'll forgive us and remember it no more. So go to God, seek his forgiveness. But don't just stay there. Don't just continue, oh God, forgive me, and continue where we are. Turn from that sin and begin using that mina that God gave you. How are you using your gifts? Maybe today you find that you're like the ones who was rejecting the master. And you've never entered into a personal relationship with Christ. Then today could be the day of your salvation. As you go to God in prayer and just, Lord, I'm a sinner. I can't save myself. Nothing I could ever do or say will measure up. But I believe Jesus died for me. So today, I want to enter a personal relationship with him. I want him to be my Savior. I want him to be the Lord of my life. I take the trust that I was trusting in myself and I place that trust in Jesus. Maybe this morning you've made that decision for him. If so, I want to hear about it. I want to know the decision you've made for Jesus Christ. So maybe tell me. Send me a message. What are you doing with your mina today? Father God, thank you for your word. Thank you for the opportunity that I've had this morning to preach your word. Lord, I pray for every person that's heard it, every person who will hear it, that your spirit will work in our lives to help us to see what we're doing with the gifts you've given us. Lord, I pray for every person that today, up until this point, has been rejecting Jesus as Master. I pray that today is the day of their salvation, that they will turn to him and trust in him and follow him. Be with us the rest of this day, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.